opportunities that, that you have to organize, and it's a great opportunity to be with the community, and it's a great event. Okay, so let's get started with the tutorial of the use of R for educational data analysis. So first of all, in order to log in the in your computer, you have to use this user, invitado aulas UD, and this is the password to enter into your computers. So once you have entered into the computers, you can download the materials of this workshop from this URL. So please go into this URL and you can download a zip file that contains all the materials that we are going to use today. What does this zip file contain? Well, first of all, there is a PowerPoint presentation that is the one that I'm going to use today here. There are also two data files that we are going to use. It's important to say that these data files are not data from real students, but I created these files. Okay, so it's not of a real experiment, but it's data that has been created by me. So with case studies. So there are two case studies, and we will go later into them. And there are also five scripts of R, so that instead of typing here and you copy and paste, if you can use these scripts and then you can copy and paste. If you open in a text editor these files, we are going to execute all of these commands that are in these files, or in some moment you don't follow some commands, you can retry later, or they will be there. So this is the files that we have. And okay, so if you have downloaded these materials, they are also available in my Twitter account. Then now we are going to start the R tool that is already installed in this computer. But first I'm going to go into the slides to say how to download if you have to install by yourself in your computers. It's really very, very easy, the installation. It's like other usual Windows programs. If you install it in Windows, also in Linux, it's very easy to install. So this is the schedule that we are going to follow today in this hands-on tutorial. It's divided into five parts. First of all, an introduction to R. So I am considering that it's your first time that you use R, so there is no prerequisites. And we will next cover some graphical representations with R. So it's important to represent the data that you have to make reports, also to check for assumptions, and so on. Next, we will cover some techniques for comparison of groups with R. Next, we will see some type of prediction with R. And finally, we will see some clustering methods. So what you can do in R is really, really very, very broad. So, I have selected some of the techniques, but of course there are many, many others. So These are just some of them, but we cannot cover, of course, everything in 90 minutes. But I hope that this gives an introduction of some of the things in ARC. ARC is a tool for statistical analysis. If you need to install by yourself in your computers, you need to go to this URL. But this is not the case today because the ARC tool is already installed here. And okay, so ARC is free software. And one typical question is, okay, which statistical tool should I use to analyze my data? And there are a lot of options. So it depends on what you want to do. Some of the advantages of ARC is that it is open source, and there is a lot of people working in developing packages, and every year a lot of new packages are there with the new things, and the community is developing all of these packages. So there are a lot of tools and a lot of statistical analysis available. You need to find the correct package according to what you want to do. The disadvantage, one of the main disadvantages, is that we should use a command line, and it's not the most user-friendly interface. There are environments like RStudio that are going to help into this issue, but other tools like SPSS, it's more user-friendly for users that are starting, because it's everything with Windows, clicks of the mouse, and so on. In ARC, we have the base commands, and then we can add additional packages as we want. So depending on the statistical analysis that we want to use, we will install different packages. We can see the present packages that are there with some commands. We will execute them now. And we can add new packages with the install.packages command, writing here the name of the package that we want to install. But there is not only a need of install the package. If we want to use it in ARC, then we need to load it with the library command and the name of the package. So this is not going to be a theoretical tutorial. So most of the time we are going to type a command. So we are going to start now to type some commands in ARC. So first of all, we need to run the ARC tool, and it's here on the desktop. So double click, and we have here the ARC tool. We are going to use today directly the ARC console without RStudio. And which RStudio adds is some more user-friendly interface to do the things. And now we are going to open, so if you have already downloaded the files and you need to unzip these files, LASI 2015, and do everybody has these materials? Okay, so if you go to my Twitter account, the files are there. But if not, there is a URL where you can download the materials. So okay, so if you have access to Twitter, in my Twitter account, directly you can click and download them. But if not, here is the URL where the materials are available. Okay, so let's wait a moment so that everybody can have the materials. And now what we are going to do is to execute different R commands. So first of all, we are going to try to get familiar with the creation of vectors, data frames, import data from files so that we can read the files into this tool, and so on. So we are going to execute command by command. I will be explaining the commands. And then, as I told you, the tutorial is divided into five parts. And we will execute the five scripts, hopefully, if we have enough time. And finally, if we have enough time, there is also a final exercise. But I don't know if we will have time or, yeah. But there is also a PDF file with an exercise there. Okay, so this is the URL where you can get the materials. And so do everybody have the materials?
Yeah.
Do you have them or? Okay. So, oh, maybe you can. Okay, so. Here it is. You are welcome.
Okay.
Okay. So now I'm going to open this intro to R. Maybe with a notepad, for example. And let's go to execute the different commands. So I'm going to copy and paste the different commands. Here with the search command, we can know the packages that are now in our installation. So this is the R packages that are here, and each R package is going to give us the possibility to execute some command. So for example, if we need a specific type of prediction, we need to install a new packet, and then when the packet is installed, if we import with the library command the packet, then it will appear in this list. So one thing is the packages that are installed, and another thing is the packets that are loaded. These are the packages that are installed, but also loaded in this image. So we can use directly here the commands of all of these packages. If we want to know the packages that are installed, then we can use the library command. And here we have all the packages that are installed here. If we execute the install packages command, this is going to give us also the information of the installed packages, but with much more information, more detailed information about the version of the package, the license, well, a lot of information you can see here about each one of these packages we can find here. So, if we want to know a specific help about one command, then we can use question mark and the name of the command. And the command, if we don't want to get an error, should be in one of the packages that are loaded into the R image. So here we are asking for help for the C command. So here we have the description of the command, and we can read the description, the exact description of the command, the arguments, and all the details, examples. This is done by the R documentation. So this is very helpful when we want to know how a command works, to try for the help. This is, for example, a test that we are going to use later in order to test for significant effects between two groups, the t-test. And if we want to know the help for this command, the same question mark, name of the command, and we can now hear all the details. Okay, so when we are working in R, there is a directory by default that we are going to use. Well, for example, if we need to import an external file, if the data from an external file, then when we try to import the data, we need to put the complete path there. Okay, but we can put also the relative path. But how can we know which is the root path from which the relative path is going to be calculated? Okay, so this is the relative path is going to start from the current working directory. If we want to know which is our current working directory, we should type the get wd command, and then this is our working directory now by default. But usually we want to change this working directory because we have our files, for example, our data file that we want to import in other directory. So, for example, imagine that instead of descargas, I put, for example, the engagement file and the learning games file, that are the files that we are going to use later. We are going to import this data into R. And I'm going to move them, for example, here in a new folder that I have just created, is Documentos R tutorial. And now, if I want to change the working directory, then I need to type set working directory. And now here, we should write the new path where we want the directory. In Windows, we need to change this slash. We can write the double slash, like this. This is going to work, or we can put this on the slash, because if not, we are going to get an error in Windows. So we do that, and now we can see that the working directory has been changed if we type the get working directory command. Okay, now about the data types in R. There are different data types. Maybe the most important ones are the numeric, the character, and the Boolean data type. I would say these three might be the most useful data types. If we want to know the data type of something, of some variable or some expression, we need to use the command class. Class and the argument is what we want to know the data type of this one, is going to give us the data type. So if we type this, we can see here how to write numeric or also characters. Also there are complex numbers, okay, with a real part and an imaginary part. Look that this is sensible to capital letters, so the true and false the logical data types should be in capital letters, otherwise it's going to be an error, like here, or it's going to be interpreted as a character if we put it in double quote. Well, we can do arithmetical operations, sum, subtraction, multiplication, power, and so on, here directly on the console. And now let's go into variable assignment. So we can assign variables very easy, so with the equals operator. So x equals to some number, and now we can get the value using the name of the variable. So this way we can put set variables and get variables. Okay, if we want to change from a data type to another data type, there are some functions like here to change to a numeric data type to an integer data type. We use the as.integer function. And well, if you execute that, you can see how the data type is changed. Now let's go into the vector, how to define a vector. A vector is a collection of elements of the same type. And now here we are going to create a vector of names of people, maybe that people that are participating in a research, in an educational research, maybe they are students. And we do that with the C command. The C command is to concatenate, in this case, concatenate elements. So with this command, we are creating a vector that is a nombre, that is a collection of strings, the names of the students. If we want to access a specific element of this, we just take nombre and the index, and you can see that the index starts in 1, not in 0, and then we can access this element. If we want to change something, one of the values of this vector, then we type the name of the vector, the index, and equals, and to the new value. So now, in Peter, it's going to change to Simon. So if we write nombre now, here is Simon instead of Peter because we have a change in value. Well, we can concatenate existing vectors also with the C command. And for example, let's see the effect of this command, in which we are going to replicate 3 times the vector nombre, and then we are going to add Pedro as an element. So if we do that, and now we see the value of nombre 2, we can see how this is 3 times the initial vector plus a new element that is Pedro. We can define also a vector of integers this way with the double point. And now if we see IDs, this is a vector of 9 elements starting from the first number that we put there and finishing in the last number. Okay, so now let's go to put some information in different vectors, for example, about the grades of 2 activities that some students have done. So we have already 9 names in the nombre vector, and these are the students of our initial case study. We have just 9 students here, and we are entering in this case the information directly in the R console. So now let's go to enter the information about the grades of these students in 2 different activities. And we can copy and paste these grades. First, we want also to put the gender of each one. And you can see if I didn't make a mistake that the gender is according to the names of the students. So man or woman. And there are the same number of elements in gender as in the nombre vector. And now let's put the different scores in 2 different activities. So here we have two new vectors with the scores of these students. When we don't know the grade of one student, then we should use in our NA structure, like here. So NA is a not defined value. Okay, we can also have lists. That lists are like vectors, but there can be different data types in a list, in a vector. All the data, all the elements should be of the same data type, but in a list it can be different. And there can also be matrices. And a matrix is like there are 2 dimensions and there are rows and columns. Okay. But maybe the most important data type that we should learn in R is the data frame. For sure, it's the most that we are going to use today. And the data frame is going to be composed of rows and columns. And it's very useful to have our data in data frames so that we can perform different R tests, statistical tests. So that some commands, or a lot of commands, need the data to be in a data frame. So we should think in a data frame as a set of rows, and in each row there will be a case of one student, for example, it will be in each row, and there will be so many columns of different features we want to model about this student. So in this case, the features, the columns will be the gender, the grades in activity number one, the grade in activity number two. So far we have the data in vectors, and these vectors are not related, so we don't know that student John is with grade whatever, because these vectors are independent. So we are going to join all of these vectors in a data frame, and we will have the data as in a table, okay, with rows and columns. So let's do that. And first of all, for example, let's create another data frame, not the final data frame for a. So this is out of the case study, it's just to try some R commands, so we will do it quickly. And here, we can have this data frame, and we can see the data frame, and we can see that the names of the columns are really not good, and we can change later, but these are the values that we have done in this data frame. And if we want to know the names of the columns, we can use of this data frame. In this case, I changed the line. We can continue with the first. We should type in this case names B1. That is the data frame that we have just defined, and these names are ugly. Okay, if we want to change one of them, we can do names B1, and now in position number one, and we can put the new name, maybe, I don't know, position. So we need to double quote here, okay, because it's a string, and now here, if we go here, this has been changed, and now the name is not so ugly here, and B1 now, the name of the column has changed. We can know each value with the number of the row and the number of the column. Okay, for example here, row 1 and column 2, and the value is true. And we can change it if we want to change to false. So we can do this way also as variable assignments. And if we want to know the number of rows, the number of columns, we can type these commands. And we can see there are 3 rows here and two columns. So the names of the columns, we can retrieve them with the names command, but if we want to know the names of the rows, this is the row.name command, and these are the names of the rows are on the left when we visualize the data frame. But by the way, I don't know if at the end you can read the or I need to do a bigger. Okay, thank you. So if it's okay, we can continue this way. And so we can change the values of the data frame by doing assignments like B1, 1, 2 equals to false, but we can edit directly with the edit command. So if we do here directly edit B1, we can see here the information in a table with rows and columns. And we can change these values. Okay, we change, we return, and this seems to be changed. Okay, but if we do D1 it has really not changed. It's 4, but it is not, it's not changed. If we want to really change with this method, we need to do d1 equals to edit d1, so that when the result of edit 1 has changed, this is really changed later. So if we do that, and now we change here to by the value 4. Now, if we type d1, this has changed now. Okay. So if we want to add, for example, a new column with the same value in all the rows, we can do this way. We can use the data frame command. And now we want the D1 data frame plus a new column with all the rows of this new column to the value 2. So this way, we have a new column with all the values 2. One very usual thing is that we want to create new variables or transform new variables. So we might want to have a new column, which is the result of some calculation between other columns. Okay, and this is very easy to do in R. So we are saying, for example, here that the new data frame will be the previous data frame and a new column that will be the result of multiplying the value of, okay, in this case, I use x1.3 because this was the name of this. Now I will need to use here the name of the column. This will be position. So we are going to multiply the values of position by 2, and this will be the result of a new column here. So here it is, and we have the new column, and this is the multiplication. So it's very usual that we need to combine different columns to obtain a new one as a transformation or a calculation. This, I think, in almost a lot of analysis, the educational analysis, you need to transfer data, create new variables, maybe compute the grades of different activities, or maybe you need to transfer your data to a logarithm because it doesn't, it's not according to your assumptions, and you need to change your data, and you need to create new columns. Okay, now let's go into the example of the grades in two different activities. And now we want to join in a data frame all the data that we have in vectors about these users. So now here, we are going to join in a data frame the names, the identifiers, the gender, the score in activity 1, and the grades in the activity 2. So now we have created this data frame, and this is a table in which we have all of this data of the students. Okay, let's imagine that we want to change instead of nombre, and we want to replace by name, the name of this column. So we can do names, and we know, okay, names, and we need the argument of the data frame. This is S, and here are all the names, and now we say names of the data frame S in position 1. It's going to be name, double quote, because this is a string, and now see S is now, well, instead of name, let's write names, and now we have this column that has changed the name. Okay, if we want to add a new column here in the data frame with all the values to true, we can use this command, and now there is a new column here. And if we want to change the name of this new column, because now it has and it's not useful, the name of this column, and we want to change to valid, now this is the data frame with the new column and the change name. If we want to create, to transfer two variables and obtain a new variable, as the result, if we want to have the final score of the activity of the course as the result of multiplying two times the grades in the first activity and summing the grades in the other activity, then we can create a new vector, and this is the global score, and in which the weights of each activity are different. One is 1 and the other one is 2. Okay, and we create this new vector. And now we can add this vector into the data frame. So we are going to type the new data frame is the same as that it was, and now we add the new score activity vector. And now here it is, and now here we have our data frame. So it is easy to create data frames and put different vectors in a data frame and add new columns, change the values of the columns, and so on. Another thing that is very, very useful is to make subsets of your data. So you make filtering of your data according to different conditions. And you want to make filtering, maybe you want to filter students by gender, or maybe depending on the grades, and so on. You can put all the conditions you want on your data. So for example, here, if we want to obtain only the data, here we have the table, but only the men, we put, okay, we want the subset of the data frame S in which gender is equal to man. Okay, and here we obtain only this data. And if we want to obtain the cases where the gender is man, but the score in activity 1 is greater than 8, then we concatenate two conditions with the ampersand command. Okay, and here we have two cases that are according to these conditions. This is very useful. We need to take the data to subset the data in many occasions when we are making analysis. Okay, and the last thing about the introduction to R is another very important thing, that is how to import data that are in external files. It can be in Excel, or it can be in a CSV file, or it can be a text file, or SPSS file, etc. Okay, so there are different commands. For example, for text files, we can use the read.table or the read.pcf command. And now what we are going to do is to import the data that we have in these two files that I have created with fictitious students. And we are going to look this data. If we open first these files, and I will explain briefly these files, the engagement file, you can see here that in the first line there are the names of the columns that we want to use. And we are going to have a data set with a students, and each row is a student. And for each student we are going to have the age, the initial grade when he starts the course. And this is going to be a number from 0 to 100. The number of tweets that he already have in Twitter, the number of activities that he had already completed before starting this course, and finally the engagement metric. So later we will try to predict, for example, engagement based on these indicators. And also we are going to do several visualizations about this data. So this is one of the case studies that are in one of the files. And the other one, also with fictitious data, is about learning games. And in this case, there is the gender of the student, the pretest, the style of learning that can be a value of 0, 1, or 2. The past project variable, that it can be, is a categorical variable, it's just 0 or 1, if pass or not pass a project. The number of videos that the student visualized, this is a continuous variable. the number of correct exercises of the student and the grade in a post-test. Okay, so one of the things we will do later is also to try to predict the value of the post-test based on other variables. Okay, so trying to know if with some interactions, if we can predict that, we are going to do also visualization. So first of all, we have this data in these files, and we need to import this data from the files into the R program. So now let's do that. And okay, so it's important that you should have these files, the engagement and learning aids files, where you define your working directory. If you don't do that, if you didn't do that, then it's going to give an error. If you give the relative path, it's not you need to use the absolute path. So now let's go into the script. And now I'm going to import URL everything. So just copy and paste here everything. And okay, here we have. So if now in one variable that is engagement, well, it is a data frame. Here it is, the data frame that we have just imported. And we can see that it's the same data that is on the file. Look that the engagement or learning games files are different because the separators are different. One is separated by commas, and the other one is separated by blank spaces. So depending on that, you need to use here a different comma. So the read table considers that it's blank spaces, but the TCF comma considers that the separator is the comma. But you can change the separator here by set equal, and you can define another separator. So indeed, you can replace whatever read.table comma by another read TCF comma and so on, changing the separators. And the header to true is because here, the first row can have the header names or not. In this case, it is there, but if it is not, the header should be too far. Okay? So, do everybody was able to import this data? We have the engagement and the learning games. So, do everyone was able to import the data? If not, I can help now. And now when everything is imported, we are going to continue with some graphical visualizations.
The configuration of the computer. But it's okay. You have here, it's the same. Yeah, it's perfect.
Okay, so, well, as I can see that we don't have a lot of time because it's at 10:30 when we finish. And so, about the graphical representations, we are not going to cover everything, but you have there the commands, but we are going to cover just a part. So now that we have already covered some basic commands in R, we are going to, we have import these files. Next, what we are going to do is to do some graphical representations. And why is graphical representations important? Well, because when we make a report, we need to put these graphics to show our data, or maybe also because we want to check assumptions of the data in order to know if we can apply or not some tests. So we are going to use mainly the ggplot library. There are many, many libraries, many, many packages in R, but this is one of the most famous and add functionality to the basic graphical capacity of app. What we are going to cover here very briefly is about representations of the distribution of one variable, a comparison among two variables in the axis X and axis Y, and a representation of several variables in the same graph, also correlograms, and this is mainly what we are going to cover. So let's go now with a new file that we are going to open now is graphs. And for example, if we want to plot an histogram, we can use the hist command. But I'm going directly, as we run out of time, I'm going directly to use the ggplot library. So for example, if we want to plot the engagement data set that we have, and we want in the axis X to have the histogram of the ingrain, and this is a variable. Okay, so in a data frame, we have as many variables as columns, and one of the variables is the initial grade of the student. And we want to represent here an histogram of the initial grade, and this is going to be in the axis X. And we want a histogram. This way we use the geohistogram function. So, okay, why is an error given here? Okay, because we don't have the package. So we need first to install the ggplot package, and we should do that with the install.packages command. And now ggplot, in this case, and here you say, would you like to use a personal library instead? And we say yes, and here yes again. And now we choose where we want to download this package. For example, in the Spanish Madrid Mirror, for example. And now this is the download. Don't worry about the warning message because it's going to work because compatibility issue. And now we have this package installed in our computer, but now we want to use here. So we need to type the library command. Give library ggplot. Okay, so it says something about. Yes, exactly. ggplot, thank you very much. So, okay, I hope in the script is correct. Yes, ggplot 2, good. So, here it is, and now all the dependencies of these packets are going to be downloaded. And now we will type library ggplot 2, and okay, here it is. So double quote is needed. Okay, and now we can use with the arouse, you can go into the history of the commands that you type, and here we are going to type, and now there is no one error. Okay, and here we have the histogram, the distribution of the ingrades. So the grades goes from 0 to 100, and we can see most of the students around 30 and 60, kind of. And the distribution of the students. So this way we can represent a histogram of one variable, in this case ingrade, with respect to the frequency of it. And okay, we can say maybe this space here is not big enough, or is not the one that I want, because this is going to go the number of times between an interval, but which is the size of the interval? We can do it smaller or greater. And we do that with the bin width parameter. So if we want to change in this histogram, and we want to put, for example, a bin width of 2, Now, the histogram chain, because the intervals that are considered for the histogram are smaller, or if we make it greater, then this has changed. Okay, so it's the same data, the same variable, but depending on the interval where you come on the times of appearance, this is going to change. Okay, you can set the limit for the x-axis or the y-axis you have here, but I'm not going to type because we run out of time. You can change the colors of the lines and so on, for example, with this command. And here, this is another histogram of the number of activities and the count of the number of activities. So we can see the distribution of the number of activities. We can have not only the histogram, but also the probability density function. And the sentences are kind of the same, but instead of geon histogram command, you need to replace that for geon density. So for example, if we want to know the probability density function of the age, here it is, the distribution of the age in this sample that we have. You can also change the title, the labs, the X labs, the Y labs. You can also try to plot in the same graph the histogram and the density function. Let's do that. Here it is. And this is for the other, for the another data set. This is the post-test variable, the distribution of the post-test. And there is the histogram, but also the density function, both in the same graph. Okay, so these, the histograms, are a way to represent one variable of your data, of your data set, in a graph. If you want to represent the relationship between two variables in a graph, then these are now some commands to do that. And again, I'm not going to use the plot, I'm going to use the ggplot because we don't have enough time to do that. And we are, for example, going to show the relationship between the initial grade and the age. So let's do that. And here we can see a representation of all the points of our data set. Each point is a row in the data frame. And we have the relationship between the age and the ingrade. So from this graph, what can we say? Okay, so it seems that at the age from 40 to 65, kind of, is the best age for having an ingrade there. And here there are, in general, more diverse grades when the age is between 18 and 25, kind of. Okay, with the graph, you can see some tendency of your data, of course, and about the relationship here, for example, of these two variables. Usually, in reports, you need to give the different graphs for a paper or to report your research. Okay, so you can also change the logarithmic of, you can change the an axis, in for example, making a logarithmic transformation if your data is in a form that you need a logarithmic in order to represent better. You can do that, and here is the command. And now, how can we represent graphically the relationship between more than two variables? Okay, because we have the axis X, the axis Y, but what if we want to represent more? Okay, there are different things. In the points that we have already seen, we can change the color depending on other variable, or we can change the shape. So let's do that. For example, we are going to represent in the axis X the age, in the axis Y the ingrade, But the number of activities is going to be represented by the color. So now, in the command, you can see it's not only the axis X, the axis Y, but also a color. Okay? So now, we have the same points as before, but now there is a color in the point, and there is a grade. And the more number of activities, the color is lighter. Okay? So we can see that in this graph. But for example, if instead of three variables, we want to represent four variables in a graph, let's do that. And now it's not only the color, but also the size of the. So now here you can see four dimensions in your graph. You have in the x-axis the A's, in the y-axis the ingrade. And you have the colors representing the number of activities and the number of tweets. The most tweets, the sizer of the point is greater. Okay? And you can see here the tendencies and so on of this data. Okay, and we have four variables, four dimensions. It's also possible to put a fifth dimension, that is the shape. We will see later how the shape is going to change that. Yes.
Is it possible to use a logarithmic scale to use the colors, or you have to create a new variable and do that?
You can use a logarithmic scale for the axis X and the axis Y. In any case, you can transfer your data for the color first, and you can do that. Well, several times in R, you can do the same things in many different ways. So sometimes the same thing, in many occasions, can be done also in very different ways. I'm not sure if it is possible directly in an axis that is not the X or the Y to make the logarithmic thing without making a previous transformation. So if you make a previous transformation, this is for sure you can do, but if not, I'm not sure if the syntax of this ggplot2 allows it or not. Okay, so for example, let's do now, instead of with the engagement example, with the learning games example. And now, okay, so here we can see in the graph that the number of tweets is not a categorical variable, or the number of activities. It's not a categorical variable, because it's not just two values or three. It's a set of continuous variables. In the other data set, there are categorical variables, like the past exam. This is zero or one, yes or no. So it's a categorical variable. Or the learning styles. There are three possible categories of learning styles. OK, and in the representation, this is a bit different when we have a categorical variable. Here, we have different scales of colors. If there is a categorical variable, there are just the colors that you have in your categories. Okay, so now let's go to see with the other example that works with categorical variables. Indeed, if we use the ggplot function here, let's look at this error. So, for example, with shape, a style of learning is a categorical variable. So there are only three styles of learning. And this is going to give an error, because the style learning variable is used for the shape. And style learning, even if it is a categorical variable, when we imported the data, R didn't know that this was a categorical variable, and it's considering as a continuous variable. So we need to change to transfer this continuous variable that is interpreted by R into a categorical variable so that we can represent it with this command. And here it is how to do that. Let's copy this. Okay, so now what I have just done is to put this past project into three categories. We can do the same with the style of learning, but here is done with another method. Let's do that also. And now, a style of learning is a factor, it's a categorical variable, it's not a continuous variable. And also, past is also a categorical variable. So this way, we can use the ggplot now with the style of learning being the shape. So let's do that. Now there is no an error. So past project cannot be a grade of color. So it should be because it's this this is a categorical variable and this is also a categorical variable. And depending on the style of learning, we have different shape. Okay, triangle, rectangle, or the other symbol, and we can see the different shape here according to this variable. Okay, so the shape doesn't admit a continuous variable. And if we have a continuous one, we need to transform this into a categorical variable. Okay. So we can also do box plots. Let's show an example of box plot. So here we are representing the grade of a post-test depending on if the student previously passed the project or not. So this is the mean, and these are other values that are in the data set. And this is the comparison between condition 1 and condition 2 depending on if the student passed the project or not. Finally, about graphs, we need to know, we can know how to make correlograms. And for that, we need to install the Ellipse package. Okay, we need to put the double quote here. Now, library Ellipse in order to load the package. And now that we have this, we can, for example, if we want to know the correlation between all the variables that were in the data frame of learning games, we use that, and now we can look at the at this variable, and this is the correlation of everything. Remember, the correlation can go from 0 to 1, and of course, the correlation with this. With itself, the autocorrelation is 1. And here you can see the correlations. But you can see the correlations graphically, and you can do that, for example, with the plot correlation. And here it is. So, of course, the perfect correlation is this. The post-test is highly correlated with the pre-test, as we can see graphically here. But what the cycles then represents no correlation at all. Okay, so depending, this is a graphical representation of the correlations between all the variables that we have in the data frame of the learning games example with the post-test, pre-test, and all the rest of conditions. Okay, so we have seen some possibilities here of graphs. Of course, there are many, many others, and also there are some commands that we have not typed, but you can type later. So I think there is a question.
Is it possible to plot a heat map directly, or is it necessary to do the same?
Yes, you can plot heat maps with some commands.
Okay. Yeah. If it's a command specifically for heat map.
No. There are, I don't remember all the commands right now. Indeed, when I did the tutorial, I don't remember, so I need to check for the documentation, okay? You can do heat maps here, yeah. Another important thing is that if you want to save some graph, and then you can use, for example, the GG save, okay, and this is going to save a PNG or a JPEG or whatever, okay? So once you have something, you can GG save and you can try it and you can save locally. If you are using RStudio, it's easier because you go in a window and you say save as, and that's it. Okay, so now let's continue into the application of some statistical tests into the data. Okay, so we have covered some introduction to R, some graphical representations of one variable, two variables, several variables, box plots, and correlograms. And now let's do something about inferential statistics. And now we need to open the screen number 3, and this is about hypothesis testing. Okay, so first of all, if we need to do some descriptive statistics to calculate the mean, the standard deviation, the minimum value, the maximum value, and so on, you can do this way with these commands. I think they are self-explicative. So, and you, for example, about the grades in activity 1, we are calculating here the mean, the standard deviation, and the median, and so on. If we want to calculate the mean, the standard deviation, and so on for all the variables of a data frame, then we need to import, to install a package that is SIG package. So we are going to install this package, and one now it's installed, but we need to take library. So next time that we enter into this computer, we don't need to install the package again, but we need to put the library command again, at least you save your image of R. Okay, so here is the library command, and now if we want to know all the descriptive statistics, we can do that by describe and the name of the data frame, and here are all the descriptive statistics. The error messages are because there are some variables for which it's not possible to calculate the mean or the standard deviation, for example, because they are characters, they are strings. So of course it cannot be calculated. Okay, but for the rest of variables that are possible, the mean, the standard deviation, the median, all the descriptive statistics are calculated at once with the SIG package with the describe command. Okay, now let's install some packages that we are going to need for making some statistical inference commands, the NORTEST and the CAR. Packets. Okay, so it's downloading some dependencies. And now let's type the library. So library NORTEST and library CAR. Go into the slides, not using the slides, but there are more information about R. You can see here the things that we have already covered. But now let's go about the comparison among groups. So here we want to make some hypotheses about two population means. So we want to we have two groups, and we want to compare one variable in these two groups. For example, we might want to compare if the grades for men are better or not than grades for women. Or we might want to know, well, this is the first example. So there are two groups, and we want to compare one variable, one continuous variable, it cannot be categorical, one continuous variable between two groups. First, the first case is that the samples are independent. So there are different students in each one of the groups. And in the case of men and women, this is true because it's going to be different groups for making the comparison. So we want to compare if the mean of the population is greater or not in one group or another. So first of all, we need to check for assumptions. So we can only apply the t-test, that is the one that we are going to use. We can only apply this test if we meet the assumptions. If there is one assumption that is not according to the data, then we cannot use the t-test and we need to use another thing. So what are the assumptions? First of all, we need independent samples between the two groups, different subjects in each group. Number two, the sampling distribution of the means should be normally distributed. And this is different. The sampling distribution is not the distribution of the sample that you have. It's the sampling distribution of the means. And this is true if you have a number of cases big enough in each of the groups. And as a rule of thumb, this is usually greater than 30. Okay, that depends on the distribution. You need to represent graphically first, and if it's close to the normality, it can be less than 30. But if it's a population that is very far from normality, you need more. But as a rule of thumb, if you have more than 30 cases, you can say that you are going to be according to this assumption. And if you have less than 30 cases in one of your samples, then you need to check for normality of the distribution of the sample that you have. Because if the distribution of the sample that you have comes from a normal population, then the sample distribution of the mean is going to be also normal. So this is one of the assumptions. And the other one, you need to check for homogeneity of variance between the two groups. And you can do that with the Leventes. So let's do that in practice. I think it's easier to do it in a practical way. Okay, so let's going to do that. The example I told you before, and the example is that we are going to compare men with women, the grades of men and women. So first of all, we divide with that subset. Remember for the introduction to R, how to make a subset. And we make a subset for men, and we have the data separated of men and women now. So here it is. And now if we make a box plot comparing men and women, we can make an initial idea. Here it is. And it seems that there may be some difference in the grades, in the scores in activity one, okay? Grades in activity one for men and women. But is it really significant or not? Or is it just by chance and there is no real difference? We really don't know. From this graph, we can have an hypothesis, but we don't know. So we need to check with some statistical analysis this comparison among the two groups. And first of all, do we have more than 30 data in both groups? That's not the case. So we cannot assume normality of the sampling distribution of the means. If we had more than 30 cases in both samples, then we didn't have a need for checking for normality. Okay, because even if it is not normal, this sample or this, that it can be the case, by the central limit theory, the sampling distribution of the mean is going to be normal. Okay? And okay, I say 30 because it's a rule of thumb, it's in a lot of books, but depending on this distribution, it can be more than 30. Okay, but let's say 30 as a rule of thumb, I say. Okay, but now we need to check for normality and of these samples, because we don't have enough cases in each sample. And in order to check for normality, there are several methods. One is graphical representation, and I'm not going to cover now. And we need to combine that with some specific test that automatically is going to give us if it can be from a normal population or not. So let's apply now some statistical tests for checking for normality. And two of the most famous tests are the Shapiro-Weil test and the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. And this is with this command. And we need to check for each of the two groups. So we apply four tests now. And you can see that the p-value is greater than 0.05. So we are going to use the 95% as the threshold. So as in all the cases is greater than 0.05, we can assume normality for this for the sampling distribution of the means of these samples. Okay, so this assumption is met. Now let's check for homogeneity of variance between the two groups, and we are going to check with the Levent test for this. And it's greater than 0.05, the probability. So we can assume also homogeneity of variance. So we have checking these assumptions, and then we are going to apply the t-test because both assumptions are met. And okay, we are going to compare men and women with the t-test, and we apply here the t-test command. And we have the group of men with the variable score activity 1, and we are going to compare with women score activity 1. And we put a confidence level of 95%. We put a false the pair variable because they are independent samples. And the equality of variance is a true, because the event, we pass the event test. So here we execute this command, and we can see a p-value of 0.3. So there is no statistically different between men and women. Okay, so it's by chance. It's not, we cannot say that this really a difference in the grades of men and women from this data. And this is the confidence interval at 95%. And you can see that it contains the zero, because there is no statistically significant there. Okay, so this is a way of comparing two groups, in this case men or women, or another case, using some educational technology or not using it, better results. Okay, and we can compare some variable in two groups. If assumptions are not met, then we will need to use the Mann-Whitney test, for example, that can be used without, if the assumptions are not met. If we want to compare, instead of grades between men and women, if we want to compare grades of activity 2 and activity 1, in order to check if grades were better in one activity than in another, okay, this data is not independent, because the same students are going to be for grade 1 and for grade 2. It's not like in the other case in which men are different from data from women. Here it's the same. So we need to apply a different test. It's also the t-test that now pair is going to be at 2-true. Okay, the confident interval you put whatever you want, and you need to check different assumption. And here the assumption is that the difference of grades should be normally distributed. The sampling distribution of the mean of the difference should be normal. So the check is not of every distribution, but the diff of the difference with this test. And as we met this assumption, believe me, because I'm not going to die, but now we can apply the t-test. And when we apply the t-test, here you can see that there is not also a statistically significant difference, because the value is greater than our threshold, that is 0.05. Okay? Good, and here we can see the confident interval of this difference. Okay, so this is just example of comparison of two groups. But there are other tests for comparison among N groups. And to compare N groups, you cannot do different t-tests because it's going to give an error. You need to use the ANOVA technique. If you want to remove variables, you need to use, to take off the effect of other third variables, you need to use the ANCOVA technique. If you have several dependent variables, you need to use the MANOVA and so on. So there are a lot of things about comparison of groups. This is just one case. And different conditions for each one.
I don't know, well, I find it really interesting that I don't know if you would like to go on with the workshop for 20, 30 minutes. So we rearrange the agenda a little bit, but we continue with the workshop. You agree or?
I can try to finish in
5 minutes.
No,
we can give you 20, 30 minutes more. And
don't worry, as, okay? As you want.
If you want, if you agree or?
You raise hands.
Yeah? You raise hands if you agree.
I want to learn.
You want to continue with the workshop? So we will rearrange the experiences to for the coffee break and so on. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I am sorry that I didn't manage well my time. I am sorry. Because I had a lot of things, but finally I realized that okay, it's not the same to type in a laptop that go here.
No, it's because it's really interesting that we are engaged, so we would like to go.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay, sorry, thank you. Okay, so now, so this is for comparison of groups. Now we are going to go into the prediction. Okay, so what we are going to do now is to try to predict an outcome, for example, engagement, or we are going to try to predict the post-test grades based on the other variables. So we have a set of data, and based on a sample, we want to predict an outcome based on other variables. It's not always to predict the future. In some cases, it's to predict the future, but you can have data that is at the same time and you don't predict the future, you predict other variables, but in some cases, you can predict the future. So maybe you can predict, you want to predict, for example, in these case examples, you want to predict the grade, the post-test grade, based on the interactions of the students with the platform, okay? And so you have the data and you are going to propose a model in order to try to predict an outcome based on other variables. And this is going to be okay for the data that you have. But what if you have other data? Okay, so what I'm going to explain here now is how to do a prediction with a method that is the regression. There are a lot of methods. We are going to cover now just the regression. And you don't need any assumptions to apply regression. And you can be surprised that I will make now, I will clarify now what I want to say. So for applying regression, you have only very few assumptions. So the only thing is that you need a continuous variable, for example, as outcome, and you need continuous variables as predictors, or a variable that is categorical with only two values. But so you can obtain a model that fits your data. So for this, there are not a lot of assumptions, but if you want to generalize, and you usually want to do that, then you need to be according to assumptions. Because if not, you cannot generalize this to other cases. Okay? So one thing is, okay, we can do that, and this fits our data, but maybe we cannot generalize. And in order to generalize, there are two, maybe the most used methods are two. Number one is to make a cross validation. Okay, you take is taking 80% of the data for fitting your model, to make your model, and 20% of your data is to check that the model you propose with the other 80% of the data is okay for the other one. And this is one way to check for generalization. But another way to check for generalization that is correct and you don't need cross-validation is to check for several assumptions in the analysis. And there are many assumptions. It's like the residuals should be normally distributed, the residuals should be independent. Well, there are many, okay? I'm not going to enter now into the theory. And you need to do that by making graphs, like the ones we did, and things like that. But we are not going to cover that part today about the generalization, okay? But be aware that the models that we are going to create, I didn't check for the assumptions, and I don't know if this data set is going to be according to assumptions, okay? Because I didn't design this part for this workshop. But if you want to generalize, so you can apply it, and this is going to fit a model that fits your data. But if you want to generalize, you need to make one of these methods, cross-validation or checking the different assumptions. This way, you can generalize to other cases. And why is what is the base about the assumptions? Okay, for example, you need to have a wide space of data in all the different values of the variables. Because if not, if you only have a subset of all the space, then you cannot generalize to other spaces. Just as an example. Okay, so now what we are going to cover is not the assumption. We are not going to cover about cross-validation, about the different assumptions for generalization, but we are going to see how to do some prediction models with regression. Okay, so let's go into the screen number 4. Okay, so now, first of all, if we want to make regression, we need that our data should not have missing values. Missing values are the values that were with NA, missing values, okay? So you can do that, okay, with the LM. Directly, the LM is going to create a regression model, and with summary, we can see a summary of this model. So, okay, with LM, we can take out the missing values, but other way is to give values. For example, in the score activities number 2, we didn't have some values, so now what I'm going to do is to replace, and this is S nuevo, a new S data frame, so that we don't have missing values in order to apply the regression. And now we are going to create a model. And this is first a very, very basic model. And in this case, we want to predict the grades in activity number 1 that are in this data frame based on the grades in activity number 2. Okay, so if we know the grades of a student in activity number 2, can we predict the grades in activity number 1? This can be the future or not, depending on if activity number 1 is before or after. Okay, so you don't always predict the future, in this case with linear regression or with regression. Okay, but in any case, we create the model. We have this symbol, I don't know how to say, but you can see how is the symbol. And on the left side, we have the outcome variable that we want to predict. On the right side, we put the variables that are going to be used for the prediction. So here it is, and now if we type summary, and the name of the model that we have created. Here is a summary of our model. And okay, the most important thing is that we can put an equation about how to obtain a score activity number one based on this. So score number one, activity number one, will be minus 0.006 or whatever plus 0.53 multiplied by score 2. So using score 2, we can try to predict score 1. And this is the equation. Okay. One important thing is the R squared value, 0.96. This value is going to say us that 96%, we can explain with this model, 96% of the variability of the score number one. This is very high, so we can explain a lot with this model according to this data. Okay, so this was with like 12 or students, kind of. But now let's go to do that with more data, with the data of engagement and learning games, where we have more than 100 rows. Okay, so let's go to create now a model in order to try to predict the engagement based on the number of tweets. So we try to, from the engagement data frame, we try to predict engagement based on tweets. So here it is, summary, model 2. And here we can see the model. And you can do the same, the equation, looking at this. These are the coefficients of the model. Okay? You can see the probability here, and at this it is less than 0.05. We can say that the tweets is statistically significant for this model. So it's a good contribution for the model with a high probability. This one says that it's highly probable that the zero is not in the constant of the equation. And here the R squared is saying us that this model can explain 40% of the variability of the engagement in this case. So the variable number of tweets is going to explain 40% of the variability of the engagement. The other 60% is not explained by this variable. But we can add more variables. We have more variables and we can try to add more variables. Okay, well, the regression, you can apply several methods. One method is the hierarchical method, in which you put the variables, you create a model, next you create another one, but you enter, you select the predictors that you want, and you select the order in which you are going to enter these predictors. There is another method that is stepwise regression, in which the selection and the order of the predictors is not selected by the researcher, but is based on statistical computations. So it's going to be selected the ones that have more correlation, and there are different iterations. So a lot of authors have a lot of pretty things with stepwise regression, and a lot of statisticians said this is not correct method. Okay, but in research papers you can use a lot this method. When stepwise regression is used, is usually required to have a cross validation, because if not, it is not is not good enough. Okay, so for example, now we are going to add. We are going to create another model in which we include not only the tweets but also the ingrate, the number of activities, and the age. So now we create this model, we make the summary, model 3. Okay, I think it's a mistake here. Here it is. So now, with when we include more predictors here, we are increasing this R squared. Now we can explain 82% of the variability of the engagement, which is much more than the 40% with just one variable. We include more variables. We are increasing here the R square, what we can explain with this model about the variability of the engagement. So there is just 18% of the variability that we cannot explain. Okay? And here, these are the coefficients for the equation.
Yes, one question. Would it be possible that when you increase the number of variables, the adjusted R squared goes down? For example, with one variable you
spend
30% and then with four,
yeah, you spend 10. Very good. This is not possible. You always increase. If you include more things, you cannot decrease. You always increase this. But in many occasions, it's difficult to increase a lot, but you always increase because when you add things, you increase. But, so, is it good to have thousands of variables to say, okay, finally, as it's going to increase even a bit, this is not a good idea at all, for many reasons. First of all, you need at least 15 cases for each new predictor that you include in your model. So if you have 100 cases, you should not have more than 6 or 7 predictors. And of course, this is just computation, but it's not a good idea to have thousands of variables and put all together there and make a computation. This is not a good idea. You should select your predictors based on previous research or theoretical foundation. Okay, and if you don't want to use stepwise regression, because it's a method that is highly criticized, the stepwise regression, you need to use hierarchical, and you need to select your variables and the order depending on theoretical foundations of what you think that may affect more, maybe based on pedagogy or other previous research or whatever. And then you should, for example, if you do one by one in a hierarchical way and you are including variables, if the increase of one variable is minimum, you should not include in the model this predictor, and you should take it out. Okay? And you can see with this probability here, all are statistically significant, all have some contribution to the model. So it is fine to maintain these variables here. But yeah, when you increase, you always obtain a better R square. But it's not a good practice to have a model with many, many predictors. The predictors that don't contribute almost nothing should be avoided. Okay, and the more predictors you have, the more cases you need. So it's not good for your model to have a lot of predictors just for putting several of them. Okay, so I think it's now 15 minutes out of time, so maybe I am going to stop now. You can see also other examples of prediction here, and also about the clustering, how to cluster the data. The R commands are there. I'm very sorry that I didn't calculate well enough the time, but I think you can have an overview of something in R, and you have all the commands. There is also a PDF file with an exercise about the comparison of groups. And okay, you have any questions? I will be happy to try to answer, maybe later or now or when you want. Okay.
I saw in the code here you are using k-means, for example. How do you adjust the number of cluster the k?
Very good. So the k-means is a technique that there are mainly two different techniques of clustering. One in which you don't set initially the number of clusters, and then the AUM method calculates the number of clusters that are going to be put there. And there is other methods in which you need to put the number of clusters. The k-means, you need to put if the clusters are going to be 3 or 4 or whatever. So there are some methods previous to use k-means to try to put to make these calculations. Yeah, but the k-means does not calculate by itself the number of clusters. Okay, so thank you very much.